mothers in the house, our mothers, grandmothers, aunts, all the women in our lives. Thank you for all that you do to make sure we reach adulthood. for not smothering us in our sleep when we're naughty, when we're little. And for staying up all night with us when we're sick. We've all had those times. So this morning, I don't know about anybody else, but I'm a little weary. So I needed some encouragement from the Lord this morning. Matthew 11, 28 through 30 says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Now, I've learned in my life there's two kinds of tired. I'm tired because I worked really hard, and there's the fruit of my labor, my garden, my deck, whatever. And then there's the I'm tired, that I'm tired, that I'm tired. Devil, knock it off. Yeah. I'm tired of fighting. I'm tired of battling. I'm tired of dealing with it. This is not what the word says, and I'm tired of dealing with it. But the answer is the same to both. He is our rest. He is our rest, whether it's affliction from the enemy, whether it's tiredness in our bones, whether it's tiredness in our souls. He is the answer. And in Isaiah 61, verse 3, he gives us a promise. "To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, and they might be called the trees of righteousness and planting of the Lord, that they might be glorified." If our spirits are heavy, if we're tired, let us put on the garment of praise. Let us turn our eyes on him. Let us let go of everything around us and lift our hands in worship to the one who changes everything. And when we do, when we let go, when we stop looking at everything around us, when we stop fighting the fight, and we truly give it over to him, and we thank him, yes, and we praise him, something miraculous happens. "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." Yes. When we let it go and give it, yes, to God, we can soar on the winds of his spirit to new heights, yes, to new glory, to new revelation of who he is and who he has created you to be. And when you soar, suddenly you can see the victory. Yes. When we rise above the clouds, we rise higher than the mountains, when we rise in the wind of his spirit, victory is all around.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen. So now we'll take prayer requests. Prayers and praises.
Come on.
And
I just thought, well, we just knew that was God that did that.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
It didn't go that way when we first walked in there.
Mm-hmm.
house of prayer. Yes, the prayers are answered, and there are a lot of things that are trying to rise up against what the Lord wants to release through this place and through his people and stuff like that. And we felt walls crumbling. Unfortunately, the enemy has layers of walls. And even though we've taken down some walls Friday night, it's evidence this morning that the walls behind these walls that everyone is testifying about, of other things that need to be taken down, now we see the next exposure. Now, in the name of Jesus, we'll walk ahead and take the next wall down. There is a breakthrough. He only has so many walls. And I appreciate everybody that came Friday night, because now that the walls have been knocked down, new things and strategies have been exposed, and now we can unite together and pray through these things. Friday night is just the beginning of what I believe is coming here. I thank Brother Tim for leading out in the prayer times, and all the rest of the worship team and other people that prayed over situations. I know when Jamie and the rest of the team went downstairs, they felt the presence of God downstairs for our children, our grandchildren down there. It's just a point of intercession. This place is prayed over. This place is rising up. This place will move the kingdom forward.
Amen.
So in that situation, the enemy always tries to come back through each of our individual lives of being tired, of being worn out, stuff like that. Just keep looking up. Keep looking up. The request I have is Cindy, she went in for her breathing situation, and it has improved, but the situation is there's a high blood pressure situation that I believe, and in claiming for her total healing on, has a high heart rate and the blood pressure situation. Then she's also sitting here fighting with the computer system to get this live stream going, but she's already put a sword through it because it's broadcasting now, and I couldn't get it to go Wednesday night to save my whatever. But she came in, and the Lord gave her the vision and anointing and the knowledge to go through it, so we are broadcasting live around the world. So the victories and the prayer requests,
yes,
they're all in his lap right now.
Praise
the
Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? Prayer requests or praises this morning? Yeah, Sheila.
My sister-in-law goes back in for more treatment tomorrow, so she just wants to pray, casting whatever. Again, that her numbers continue to go down to zero and be perfect, and she asks every time she's going in that the Lord just gives her, you know, complete peace and no fear. Likewise with my aunt, still continuing treatment too.
And I'd like to request prayer. Zach and Craig are graduating, and the world is wide open for them, and that they have been rooted and grounded in truth as they go forth into the world.
Amen.
God has plans for those boys. Yeah, anyone else this morning? All right, let's stand. Oh, yeah.
He's feeling sick.
Jamie?
He's been feeling sick.
Evelyn, you got a good report. She had doctor's appointments both Monday and Tuesday, and she got excellent reports, and she wanted to thank everybody for her prayers.
Yee.
Praise the Lord.
She's in order.
All right. All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your rest, Lord. We thank you that it is finished, Lord. We let it go, and we put it in your hands, Lord. When we speak your word, we just thank you.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for the healing. We thank you, Lord, for the deliverance. We thank you, Lord, for the reconciliation. We thank you for the good reports, Lord. We thank you that you make all things new, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you go before us and you make a way where there seems none, Lord. We thank you that nothing is impossible with you, Lord. We thank you that your arm is not short, that you know every need, Lord. Before we speak it out, you know the needs, Lord. That every member of this body is precious, Lord. Precious to you and precious to each of us, Lord. Let your hedge of protection go around each person in this body, Lord. Encourage those that are weary, Lord. Lift them up, protect them, give them peace.
Lord,
as we trade in that spirit of heaviness for a garment of praise, Lord. That you are worthy no matter what our circumstance, Lord. That we will praise you. And we will lift you up and magnify your name, the name above all names, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. thank you, Lord, that you don't give up on those that struggle, Lord, that you don't give up on those who lose those battles in their will and their mind. That you will not let thank you, Lord, that you draw those in by your loving kindness. It's your love and your grace and your mercy that draws men to you, Lord. Let us love like you love, Lord. Let us remember each person and their struggles, Lord. Let us be an encourager. Let us speak words of life and truth into those that we come across, Lord. Oh, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. For your blessings are yes and amen. And every promise in your word is yes and amen. And we believe the promises. We believe, Lord, that you are good. Even when they're wrong, they're right. I think that's in the scripture somewhere. No, I'm kidding. Even when they're wrong, they're right.
Thank you.
Zach's graduation breakfast, Saturday, May 16th, 9 a.m., Sailorville Fire Department. And graduation reception, Sunday the 17th at 2 p.m. at the McBride home. And Chris is at 3, 3 to 6 in Waukee. I forgot my announcement. Sorry. Craig Marshman graduation party. Thank you. I forgot the picture. I have a postcard. So graduation's for our young men. So just well wishes on Facebook or if anybody has cards or whatever, that'd be appreciated for the boys. Let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles or hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And Abraham's blessings are mine. Lord. John, you want to come take the offering this morning? Juan.
Lord, we praise you today, God, because you're worthy all the time. And we just want to gather together here this morning, God, your favor over us. We just thank you for that, Lord, the opportunity to sow and give into your kingdom, your blessing on this offering, we pray, and the people as they give. And God, we just want to worship you this morning, that you inhabit our praises as you say you will. We just thank you for that. We just want to glorify the name above every name, in the holy name of Jesus.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah. A little change up. Brother James is at an air show, has an air show, so we got to listen to Roberto's jokes this morning. Good, now meet me, bro. Thank you. Hallelujah. So let's just worship the Lord, for he is worthy of our praise as we take down some more strongholds in the name of Jesus. Freedom from the chains that bind your children. Freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you. Freedom from the lies of the enemy. Freedom. I cry freedom from the chains that bind our children. Freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you. Freedom from the life of the enemy. Chains that bind your children, the freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you, the freedom from the life of the enemy, freedom. I cry freedom from the chains that bind your children. Freedom from the chains that bind our praise to you. Freedom from the lies of the enemy. I want to praise a little longer than before. I want to lift my hands higher than before. I want to shout a little louder than before. I want to shout a little louder than before. For freedom, 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 freedom. I want to worship a little deeper than before. I want to love you more than before. I want to dance more freely than before. I want to dance more freely than before. Freedom, 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 freedom. I want to worship. I want to worship a little deeper than before. I want to love you more than before. I want to dance more freely than before. I want to dance more freely than before. We cry freedom. Freedom, freedom, voices, freedom, 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 yeah, freedom, freedom.
Glory, glory, Jesus.
And with
And with a crown of thorns, you became my king forever. And with a crown of thorns, you became my king forever.
That saved me, that rescued me.
Just a moment there, it set me free.
That saved me, and rescued me. Just a moment there,
it set me free.
I give you glory, glory.
I give you glory, glory.
I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord! We will dance for your glory. We will dance, we will dance for your glory.
We will dance for your glory, Lord.
We will lift up a shout to adore you.
Every sound that we make is
for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
Your salvation's in this place. Let your name be lifted high as our thankful hearts now cry. Jesus, Jesus.
Lift up your head, you ancient faith. Be lifted high, you ancient love.
The King is coming in.
King is coming in.
Lift up the shout to shake the stars. Lift up and cry, be glorified. The King is coming in.
The King is coming in.
We'll dance for your glory. We will dance, we will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every shout that we make, it is for you. We will dance
for your glory, Lord.
For salvation's in this place. With the name of which was saved, Jesus, Jesus. Let your name be lifted high. With a thankful heart, shall cry, Jesus, Jesus. Lift up your head, you ancient gates. Be lifted high, be ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. We lift the high, be glorified. The King is coming in.
We
We're the people of God with a song to sing. And we're bringing our lives as an offering. We will dance for your glory, Lord. As the cross is a hope and it hold on high, as we tell the world of it, love and life, we will dance for your glory, Lord. Lift up your head, you ancient gate. He's left it high, the ancient God. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up the shout to shake the skies. Lift up the cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory. We will dance, we will glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. We will sound and make news for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord! Hallelujah, Lord! Hallelujah, Lord! Woo! Hallelujah, Lord! Hallelujah, Lord! Lift up your gates! Lift up your gates! Lift up your gates! You guys are hammering down. Woo! You know, there's a loose steeple on the roof. I was up there the other day, and I could actually rock it back and forth about 3 or 4 inches. I hope it's still up there. If not, it's just one less thing to do, taking it down, because we're going to be making a new one, so maybe the project's half done. I don't know if the gutters got cleaned out here. Maybe we'll do it this week now that the trees are done. Did you get it already, Pastor? Okay. Well, maybe we got them cleaned out too. Hallelujah. Let's just keep worshiping Him and maybe we get it all done. I don't have to worry about it. Hallelujah. Your mercy endures forever, Lord.
How great is your goodness? How great is your kindness? How great is your mercy to me? How great are your wonders? How great is your power? How great is your favor to me? Now sing of all your faithfulness. your name. I celebrate your name.
Lift up your name, Lord.
You are a faithful God. You will never change. And I will celebrate your name.
Healing in his wings, church.
And all my soul cries for your love.
He's healing right in the room right now. He's healing.
You are the God.
Just reach out. Just reach out. Let him touch.
You are my strength and my song. So I lift up my
you are all my heart.
cries of my heart, Lord.
Oh, Lord, we love you this morning. Appreciate your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your favor, for your grace, for your goodness. Thank you for you, Lord. Never changing, same yesterday, today, and forever. We love you today, Lord, and we bless your name, the name that's above every name.
Yes.
And in that name, Lord, we speak to the enemy with authority. No weapon formed against us can prosper. Every tongue that rises in judgment, we condemn.
Yes.
Hallelujah. The words that we speak are spirit and their life. There's power in the words that we speak. When we're in agreement with the Word of God, nothing can prevail but that Word. Just like the rain comes down from heaven and the snow falls, if we'll repeat it, if we'll declare it, it will not come back to the Lord void. It will accomplish whatever He sent it to accomplish. I just encourage you, whatever you're facing, there's a promise in here, and that promise is the final word, the last word. There's lots of stuff being said, lots of things being argued about your situation, but we have the final word, the last word, the word that prevails, and it's the Word of God. Hallelujah. Give Him a big hand clap this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated, and thank you, worship team. Half the team, and they sounded like well, at least twice as much. Praise the Lord. You're great. You guys did wonderful as always. Hallelujah. The drummer is still at it. Praise the Lord. Multitasking. Praise the Lord. Amen. Happy Mother's Day again to everybody, to especially the mothers. That's amazing how you see college football games, baseball games, whatever, and they're always holding up a sign, "Hi, Mom." And you got these big, huge professional athletes. I mean, just awesome, you know, and powerful. And they stick a mic in front of their face, and the first thing they say is, "Hi, Mom." It's never, "Hi, Dad," is it? I mean, I don't remember. It's always, "Send me money," maybe, but never, "Hi, Dad." It's always, "Hi, Mom." Praise the Lord. Moms are special. Amen. Without them, well, none of us would be here. And so they're great. Hallelujah. And we celebrate them every day, but especially this one day out of the year that we set aside specifically for that purpose. So God bless all you moms. Keep up the good work. Hallelujah. We need all the help we can get. Hallelujah. Somebody, I think it was Suzanne, was saying that, you know, they stand by us until we grow up. Well, the truth is, either we never grow up or they just don't let go, one of the two, because, you know, moms are always in our lives no matter what, no matter how old we get. As long as they're here, we're still their kids, right? And so we never get past all of that, and that's it's a great thing. We appreciate all the mothers. Praise the Lord. I want to, this isn't really my text, but Suzanne mentioned it, so let's go there, first of all, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Thank you, Jesus. Obviously. Either that or my eyes were a lot worse than I thought. There you go. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now try to picture that in your mind, and we'll all be there. Okay, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, if that isn't a contradiction in terms of what we normally think of religious experiences being about. But Jesus came not to establish a religion. He actually came to overthrow one and to establish relationship with God again. This is, you know, it's amazing how difficult religion has made this whole experience. And it's the simplest thing in the world. You simply believe. And that's it. Everything else takes care of itself from there on out. There's no responsibility on our part to be accepted. We are accepted in the beloved. Religion has made this a big job and very exhausting. I mean, anybody that's been around religious people or maybe have been through this thing yourself, you know, there's nothing inviting about it. There's nothing really attractive about it. And it's exhausting. It wears you out trying to be, you know, something, you know, perfect and righteous and holy and all that in and of ourselves. And it's a turnoff to most people. They look at it and they go, oh, man, how boring. You know, I mean, how tiring. You know? That's what Jesus is saying here. If you come to him, all that stuff's over with. All that laboring, all that working, all of that effort to be something special. You are simply special because he has chosen you, because he gave himself for you. Amen? So that's the first thing. Now, let's go from there. I want to start in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 2. There's obviously quite a few people that aren't here today because of sickness and other issues, but so I'm not talking about them when I say this. But people have said, you know, I don't really want to hear any more that he has to say because all he ever talks about is grace. In fact, there are people that aren't here, and they're not here for that reason.
That's right.
I'm not talking about the people that are regular here that are just gone for various other reasons, but people that have actually left and don't plan on coming back. Amen? Mm-hmm. Well, you know, that's disappointing on one hand, but on the other, you know, so be it. If you want to continue to wear yourself out, that's your business. But personally, I like just being me. Mm-hmm. And being me doesn't fit that religious kind of mold. And praise the Lord. Anybody that knows me, really knows me, knows that's true without me having said it, but nevertheless, I'm not a religious person. I'm just about probably as normal, you might even say carnal. Of course, I wouldn't, but as anybody. I mean, I'm naturally supernatural. I don't have to pretend. I don't have to be all spooky and freaky. I just am. And so I can be me, right? And the problem is that people that are not maybe, you know, involved in a relationship with Lord in any meaningful way, with any depth, they see that as being, well, they're just like me. Well, that's exactly right. I'm just like you, except I have this relationship with the Lord. Right? I mean, I don't have to be anything else. I don't have to, you know, wear a collar backwards. I don't have to have a big cross dangling off of my... Nothing wrong with any of that, you know, and I don't have to have a sticker on the back of the car that says, honk if you love Jesus, or, you know, follow me to the Lord, or whatever. I don't have any of those things because I've said it before. I don't even have a pastor's thing on there. I have to find a parking lot in the hospital just like everybody else. Because I know at some point between here and there or here and home, somebody's going to pull out in front of me. Somebody's going to do something really stupid, and I'm going to get stupid too. I'm going to say something or do something, amen, that could be a bad reflection, you know, on the Lord. So I don't do that. I'm just traveling incognito, praise the Lord. But I would, you know, if I can say or do anything, whoever it is. I mean, I talk to people all the time, just like all of you do, you know, at the grocery store, the dry cleaners, the bank, and whatever. And if I can just help them to understand how much God loves them without their effort, without their religiosity. You know, just be you, you know. Just relax and let God take care of it. That's all he wants to do. He's not asking you to be some freak show or some really odd, weird thing. He's just asking you to trust him. And when you do, you can rest, like the scripture says. The effort, the onus is no longer on you to perform. He's already performed. He's done everything that we weren't capable of doing. Now we rest in that finished work. We get the good stuff because he took the bad stuff. It's an exchange. That's all. That's what it is. That's what Christianity is all about. It's not a religion. It is simply he has made it possible for us to have this relationship with God. Even with all of our natural human flaws, we're still accepted by God. He sees us perfect. Praise the Lord. All right, so this is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Now, I got saved over 30 years ago, nearly 35 years ago now. And I used to, now you're going to think, here he goes, he's bragging. I'm trying to make a point. But when I got saved, I got radically saved. And my life was kind of a disaster in a lot of ways. Drugs and alcohol and relationships and all that kind of stuff. So when I got saved, I thought, man, I got a big debt to pay. I'm really going to have to do some stuff to get even with the Lord. Now, I didn't think this way, you know, all the time, but yet something inside of me was driving me. So I would cut the church grass. We had a big church. And there was probably, 3.5-4 acres of property around it. And so I'd cut the grass. And I wanted to. I didn't do it because anybody made me. I wanted to do it. So I did it. And Sally cleaned the church. I'd help her do the cleaning. It was a large church. And I put up the sign every week. We'd have a different thing, you know, all the time. And so I'd try to put up something that wasn't too offensive. A couple of them I had to take down after the pastor saw them, but most of them got to stay up. But I'd do that every week. I drove the van for bus ministry. On Saturdays, we'd go out and go around the whole. We had like a school bus plus, I think, 3 or 4 regular vans. And each bus had its own territory, and we'd go out on Saturday and meet the kids and the parents and make sure that they knew what time we were coming and give them a little treat or something to talk to them a little bit. And so we did that every Saturday and then get up early before church to go out and pick these kids up then on Sunday. Eventually I became the head of the bus ministry, and I taught junior high Sunday school. I taught the new converts class, which was larger than this church. And taught multiple Bible studies in our home and in other people's homes. Went to every service, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night, youth, everything. I mean, whenever the church was open, we were there. Even when the church wasn't open, a lot of times we'd go and open it so we could be there. Went to every revival, knock doors, hand out tracts. We used to just wait for an opportunity. The fire department one time, I remember, were raising money for the fire department. But they were stopping traffic. So we just got out with the firemen and started handing out tracts. While they were taking money, we ran out tracts until they ran us off. But it looked like a perfect opportunity to us because the cars couldn't go anywhere. They already had their windows down, so, you know, what are you going to do? And eventually I became a licensed minister and was ordained and so forth in that organization. I preached in Texas. I preached in Iowa, Missouri, Nebraska, Illinois, all over the Midwest. And I don't have any idea of the amount of exposure to the Bible that I had. I can't even begin to try to calculate the hours and the days and the weeks, the years even. And yet, with all of this, I totally missed what Christianity is all about. Praise the Lord. I'm not saying I wasn't saved. I'm saying I missed what real Christianity is all about. Now, I don't know where you are today in terms of time spent. Long-time Christian, short-term, relatively new, maybe just trying to figure out if it's something you even want to be interested in. But there's one truth in the Bible that's more important than all of the rest. I love the Bible and all of the truths that are in it. And I believe every single word. I believe it's all inspired of God, and I believe it's all important. But there is one truth of the greatest importance. And I don't mean that the others are insignificant, but this one truth is huge. In everything that Paul wrote, and he wrote two-thirds of the New Testament, he says that the good news is the main thing. Now, y'all understand the expression, keep the main thing the main thing. You know, it's like the old saying, when you're draining the swamp and you're up to your waist in alligators, sometimes it's difficult to remember that the mission is to drain the swamp because you're so busy dealing with the alligators. Well, that's kind of what we heard this morning, right? I mean, that's the way it gets sometimes. Our mission is just to love God and be loved by Him. But sometimes the alligators are snapping all the time and you lose track of what the actual mission is because you're so busy fighting the enemy. But there's a great truth, and it's the main thing. And let's look at this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. So God says that the gospel is the most important truth in His Word. It's first and foremost. It's the most important. It's of, one translation is first importance or most important. And every other biblical truth falls in line behind this basic teaching, this basic truth. Everything else is behind this. I mean, I'm not saying it's not important. I'm just saying everything else falls in line following this.
Yes.
So to live as a Christian is to live in step with the truth of the gospel. Not to live some rigid, rule-keeping, legalistic kind of life, but to keep in step with the gospel. What is the gospel? It's good news. It's grace. It's the grace of God, the favor of God that has come to us freely and saved us. So to live for God isn't a bunch of rules that you're supposed to keep. It's to live from that understanding, to live your life out of this acceptance that God has accepted you, that God loves you, that God wants to bless you. Most of the times we struggle with those things because we don't feel we have a right to expect God to do good for us. You know, we pray, but we're praying out of fear more than we're praying out of faith because we think we know ourselves well enough that we don't really deserve God's blessings, His favor, right? Well, that's true, but we do deserve it simply because Jesus purchased it for us.
Amen.
He paid the price. People think God's mad. God is not angry. He poured out all of His wrath on Jesus so that He can love us openly, freely, without any reservation.
Thank you, Lord.
You're special to God.
Yes.
Absolutely special to God. He gave His life for you. And I know that becomes almost cliche, but it is an absolute truth. He exchanged His life for ours. Mm-hmm. We have a right to expect blessing Amen? Healing, prosperity, deliverance in every situation, every time, without question, and without fail.
That's right.
Amen? Galatians chapter 2, verse 14. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, If thou being a Jew livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? Now, he's talking about, these are Christians, they were Jews, but they've been born again, they've been saved. And Paul calls Peter out, and the reason he calls him out is because Peter's not living this life, he's not walking according to the gospel. He is establishing rules and regulations for people to follow. And he says, look, you're a Jew. You've got all these rules. We've got hundreds and hundreds of laws that you're supposed to follow. And he said, you being a Jew, you're not living by those rules. You've been set free from them. So why are you now demanding that the Gentiles who never had any law now come and live under the law? Praise the Lord. So he's saying, look, you're not living according to the gospel. You're not living according to grace.
Right. Right.
So he calls him out. Now look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. Now I'm guessing Paul knows what he's talking about since he wrote two-thirds of the New Testament, right?
Right?
Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, in one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel.
Yes.
So he's basically telling these people in Philippi the same thing that he said to Peter.
Come on.
Just stay focused on the gospel. Forget about all the other stuff. Just stay focused on God's grace that he has saved you and delivered you from any legal repercussions for your behavior and for your failures as a human being. Say, so, oh man, well now that just sounds like chaos and confusion. No, it's the gospel.
Right.
It is the gospel. I can't control people. And believe me, you can't control people whether you're screaming and hollering about them all going to hell and what the rules are that they're breaking. You can't make them do things any more that way than you can by what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is the truth. And I'm not saying people don't have good motives when they threaten you with hell, 2 hours on Sunday and any other time they can get your attention. But hell is not an issue for us.
Right.
If we're believers, I don't know why you want to talk about hell all the time. I had people, when we were in the other organization, we started a church in Ankeny, and I had guys get up and leave because I wouldn't preach hell. I wouldn't preach enough about sin. And I thought I was preaching plenty about sin, because I wasn't dealing with the scriptures the way I do today. I mean, I still believed in grace, but I didn't really understand the depth and the width and the breadth of it. But got up and left. And in fact, one man came to me at one time. He said, don't you care about us, Nathan? And I said, what do you mean, don't I care about you? And he said, well, you don't preach about hell. I said, well, what do you want to know about it? I mean, are you planning on going there? You want to be prepared? He was serious because I wasn't angry enough and I didn't yell enough and I didn't threaten enough. He felt unloved.
Wow.
Go figure. But the Christian life is formed by the glories of the gospel. The glories, not the horrors. It's patterned and it's powered by the gospel of grace. Everything in here is, in all of life and for the rest of life. It's what it's about. Without the gospel, we lack the proper understanding of any doctrine. We lack the ability to even really know God. Now, I believe in the power of God. I've seen people healed. I saw one, if not two people raised from the dead. I didn't have perfect theology, but I did believe God wanted to do it, and so God did it.
Hallelujah.
And those are just a few that sound like really big things, but there's been many, many big things. They were big things to me when I needed financial help, when I needed this or that and the other, and it didn't look like there was any way I was going to be able to produce it, and God still did it. You know, being supernatural, something I've learned over the years, is more about just believing God than it is about anything else. Now, the way we respond to that is different for all of us. Some of us are more confrontational. Some of us are more outspoken. Some of us are louder. Some of us are not so much. But what I've learned is I don't have to be anything other than just me. I don't have to preach a certain way. I don't have to approach other people, you know, from some superior kind of attitude. Because I've seen people healed and delivered by people that I never would have imagined, you know, could function in that realm. But what I've learned is it's just God. And He don't care. He wants people healed. We were in a little building. It was part of a garage, a big garage complex, when we first came to Iowa. In fact, we were in a Legion Hall for quite a while, and then we moved into this building. We remodeled it and did some stuff, but it was still just a little kind of weird place. We had a big tent meeting, had a big name preacher from Texas come up. And of course, it was all just us Pentecostals, with the exception of one friend of mine, a drug-dealing alcoholic. Big Blue. And it was strange. And we didn't look anything like, you know, like we had great power with the Lord or anything. But we saw healings. We saw miracles happen. Not in that tent meeting, but just in our weird little services. I started preaching with a milk carton or milk crate, like they used to carry milk in, upside down with a towel over it. That was the pulpit, just on a big table. Me, Sally, and the neighbor kid, and our daughter. That was basically it. Boy, she got dramatically transformed by my preaching. The only one. But it did grow, and we, you know, eventually we got into this building. And there was a little kid. He was from a large family. He was just a toddler. He was just walking, but he was having trouble walking because one leg was dramatically shorter than the other. Remember that? And we're just praising the Lord and praying and praying for him. And he just took off across the floor, came back, and his mother's freaking out, screaming and hollering. His leg grew out.
Hallelujah.
Just, he's like, 4 years old, something like that.
Glory.
Just like that. We couldn't believe it. And we were praying, but we couldn't believe what God had done. I mean, that kind of stuff happens.
Yes.
And it's not because... I mean, it wasn't because I had everything all figured out, because I was just as shocked as everybody else. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We were supposed to be taking my daughter, my oldest daughter, to Oklahoma, wasn't it? And we're going to meet my son-in-law, and he was going to pick him up. Well, I'd been working. I was working a secular job, too, at the same time. And I got off work, and I picked him up and took him where we were going. And I don't know, somewhere I made a wrong turn or something. I got way off. I ended up in Kansas. And it's like 2 o'clock in the morning, and I just said, hey, Bill's going to have to come here and get them. They're his now. I mean, he married her. Yeah. So come up and get them. I can't do this anymore. So we got a motel room, and he showed up, picked up my daughter and I think one child she had at the time. But anyway, he got them and left. So the next morning I got up, and I was hungry all night, but I didn't want to stop, take the time to get something to eat and, you know, throw the schedule off even further. So I got up, and I was sleeping and waking, and all night I was thinking about food. So I got up, and I said, we're going to go to, it wasn't IHOP then, I forget, Shoney's. So just the whole breakfast thing, you know. So we get in the car and we take off, and I think I'm going in the right direction to where Shoney's is, and I end up on my way to Lawrence, Kansas, which is the opposite place that I wanted to be. So I turn around and I come back. Now I'm in a state, I'm not even supposed to be in this state, and I'm in the wrong end of town from where I want to be. And the Shoney's, I pull in, we go in and we eat, and we're listening to these women, because I'm a horrible eavesdropper in restaurants. That's why you want me in a booth, because I'm always listening to everybody else. And there's these three older women, and they're sitting there all bragging about their kids, and one's a teacher, and one's a lawyer. And I'm just getting a kick out of listening to the conversation. And they carry on their conversation. Finally, they get up and leave. After they left, they just went out, and we got ready to leave, and I was standing at the cash register getting ready to pay, and in runs this woman, and she said, I got to use the phone. This woman's died in the parking lot. And so she calls 911. They've sent in an ambulance, and this is a registered nurse. And while I'm standing there, I hear the Lord say to me, pray for her. Honest to God, I didn't hear it out loud, but I heard it as clear as if it had been out loud. Now, I'm in the wrong state, in the wrong end of the town in this state. I'm not even supposed to be here. And I'm thinking, Lord, I don't pray for dead people. I mean, I've prayed for people that were sick, but I've never prayed for a dead person. I thought, I'll just make a fool out of myself. And I'll embarrass you, because I'm looking out for the Lord, you know. I don't want to shame him. And he just, again and again, it kept coming on. And I walked out. And I walked over to where the woman was lying between the sidewalk and the parking lot in this little grass space. And no vital signs. She had defecated and urinated. I mean, just what bodies do a lot of times when they die, the functions just go off. And she's laying there with her eyes rolled back in her head. And no pulse. I've been around dead people, so. I was relatively sure she was dead, and there was a registered nurse standing there telling me she was. And so I thought, well, let's just get this over with, because I got to do it. The Lord's telling me to do it, but I'm not expecting much. So I just laid my hand on her and said, in the name of Jesus. And she jerked like 220 went through her. Wow. Her eyes popped. She sat up, and the nurse come over. Sally, tell you, the nurse come over and said, hold, ma'am, lie down. We've got an ambulance coming. And the woman said, no, I'm going home and taking a shower. Wow. Got up, her friends helped her to the car, and they drove off.
Wow.
We went, and I'm just sitting there looking like, what happened here? What is this? We went back to our little van, whatever it was, what do you call them? Minivan, yeah. And got in the car, and I'm in shock, so when we get in the van, then immediately the presence of God just like explodes in this van. I mean, I'm crying, I'm laughing, I'm carrying on. It was insane. But my point is this. It wasn't like some spiritual giant went out and prayed for this woman. This is just an average guy having breakfast in the wrong place at the wrong time. But God knows exactly what he's doing. We worry so much about our plan and getting, you know, being in the right place at the right time. Look, you can be where you think you're totally out of sync with everything, and God brought you there. God got you there through your own stupidity, through your own kind of ignorance. And I think he's just trying to prove something to me that this isn't about you. All I'm asking is just believe me. Even with your flawed belief. Like I talked about here a week or so ago. Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. That was that. That was that situation. I know you can do it, Lord, but it's not likely it's going to happen today. I mean, they didn't call me to come down here and do this, and actually they were uncomfortable with me even praying for the woman.
Right.
I didn't get to talk to her. I didn't get to give her a track. I didn't give her the plan of salvation. Just prayed for her, and she's gone. But she's alive, gone, you know? And I'm saying we put so much emphasis on us and our understanding all of the scriptures just right. God just wants us to know him. He just wants you to trust him. And there's nothing that he won't do. Amen? In the gospel, in God's gospel, he's reconciling all things to himself.
Yes.
He's bringing everything back to him. Everything is going to come back to him.
Yes.
Why? For the praise of his glory. Now, I guarantee you, that was probably the most sincere praise and worship that I've ever experienced when we got back in that van. Because I knew God had done something miraculous. And he chose to use me, as screwed up as I was and as flawed as I was and as insecure in this kind of thing as I was. I knew who did it.
Yes.
And it wasn't me. I wasn't taking any bows. I wasn't taking up an offering. I wasn't trying to book another meeting. You know, I was just wanting to get alone with the Lord because I'd seen how awesome he is. I'd seen the glory in a way that I never thought I ever would see it. It was just amazing. Nothing compares to the gospel in giving glory to God. Because it moves us right out of the picture. It focuses on him. It's all about him. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. She's doing fine. That's a future tither there. Just praise the Lord. Of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Let me ask you, when you hear the gospel, does it perk you up? I mean, does it excite you? If you don't quite get the excitement of the gospel, you need to preach it to yourself. Like Paul prayed for the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 17 through 20. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. What that says is all the power that we're looking for comes from through the gospel of grace, not through other stuff. Amen. I went one time, because this is all about me. Yeah. Now, I'm just telling you this because I'm telling you, I'm not saying this to be self-deprecating or to be humble. I'm saying this because it's the truth. My pastor used to send me to these weird situations. I always got the incestuous relationship that had to be honest to God. And I mean, I'm not comfortable in this situation. But he wouldn't tell me ahead of time. He'd just say, I need you to go see these people and sit down and talk to them. I'm sitting there thinking, it's just a little family thing. I mean, everybody has issues. And the next thing I know, one girl's talking about I was sitting in my mother's lap when my dad blew her brains out. A young girl named Teresa ended up marrying a goat roper in Texas. Yeah, taught him a Bible study. She was messed up. As you might imagine, any person would be if they'd witnessed the assassination of their mother while sitting in their lap by their father. But she came to the Lord. I'm not saying she had a perfect life, but she came to the Lord. And so did her future husband, Malcolm. Yeah. Another one was an incest situation. And I mean, I just felt totally unprepared for any of this. I didn't have, you know, counseling training or anything else. I was just sent out to do it. And it was always the most bizarre. At first, I thought it was just because my pastor didn't want to deal with him. But I realized it was wisdom on his part. He was exposing me to stuff. So if I was gonna be discouraged or run off, it would be better to be discouraged and run off now, not after you're pastoring a church someplace and everybody else is expecting you to be the role model, right? It was bizarre. It was just weird. I went to a Catholic hospital because I got a call. He said, go down there. I want you to go pray for this guy. He was a son of people that were in the church, but he wasn't a church member. He didn't come to church. In fact, he mocked everything about the church. And I went, and it was a Catholic hospital, nuns and priests everywhere. And he was in a diabetic coma. They didn't even know he had diabetes. But his blood sugar was like 1,500 or something, and it was just unbelievable. So went up and prayed for him. They already had the sheet pulled over him, over his head. And when I went in, the whole family was in this room downstairs with a couple of nuns. And I was so awkward in the situation that I didn't know what to say to him. You know, I didn't have any real hope for him. I'm hearing he's dead, you know. So it wasn't like I had this great man of faith, you know, I'm just going to give him the words, it's going to bless him and it'll all be good. I said, well, let's just pray. And I just started praying in tongues because I knew I didn't have any eloquent prayer that I could pray. It would have just, you know, I would have just been stumbling along trying to think of what I'm going to say while I'm saying it. You know what I mean? Sometimes how you, it just doesn't flow. Well, I was so tense and so miserable in this situation and unable to do anything for them. So I just prayed. Went up to the room because basically I wanted to get away from the family because I was embarrassed that I didn't have anything to help them, say anything or do anything for them. So I went up to pray for him. He's covered up with a sheet. Prayed for him. He was healed. In fact, not just raised from the dead, but healed of diabetes. He never had any diabetes after that. So I come back down, and there's nuns speaking in tongues in the foyer in this Catholic hospital. It wasn't a charismatic Catholic hospital. It was a very strict order of Catholics, and the Spirit of God just did it. I went and visited that kid two or three times on behalf of his parents. To my knowledge, he never came to the Lord. He never got saved. But he did get healed. It was the goodness of God, the mercy of God, the love of God for him. And you couldn't have found a more feeble, inept vessel to use than me. And nobody knew it better than me. But that's the glory of God. That's how I know what God can do. Yes. And it's what he wants to do in all of us.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And he wants us to know we're not the issue.
Right.
It just enough faith to even go. I went more out of fear than I went out of anything else, and yet God did. I could go on and on and on. There's plenty of stories that I could tell you. And I'm not saying it so that you think, wow, isn't he something? No, I'm saying it because I am not anything different than you. I'm not special. Ask my wife. I go to the bank twice a week, and these girls they've gotten to know me. They always say, "How you doing, Nate?" I'll talk to them a little bit, and I just irritate the people behind me mainly. They have to wait a little longer. But I usually do the same thing. I mean, I have the same routine. So the other day I'm in there and this gal says, "Hi Nate, how you doing?" And I said, "Just same old," and stuck my deposit in there. And she said, "Well, same thing as always, huh?" And I said, "Yep." I like to think of it as being consistent, although my wife says I'm just redundant. So so that's kind of my life. I'm not necessarily perfect. I'm redundant. I'm just, and we all are. We just are not, it isn't like we got it all together. You know, look, if you and I can say this about my own wife, if we agreed on everything, we wouldn't need one of us. I mean, one of us would be redundant, right? That's the way I look at life. I don't expect everybody to agree with me. I don't even want them to. I mean, if you agree with everything I say and I agree with everything you say, one of us needs to just go home. Right? So it's okay to not agree on everything. It doesn't make either one of us wrong or bad. It just makes us human. And God needs those differences, because if you and I agree, we're only going to talk to this, we're only going to meet the same people. We're only going to deal with the same situations and the same circumstances. He needs diversity. He needs us to be who we are. Weak and feeble as that might be, He don't care. I mean, it's our weakness, our strength is made perfect in weakness. How? My strength isn't any different. It's His strength that comes.
Right.
And it comes to my weakness. It comes to my acknowledging God. If you don't do this, it ain't going to get done. I can't do it. I know you can. I'm just depending on you showing up. And it's true in every situation, whether you're praying for somebody else, whether you're praying for your own situation, your own circumstance. The devil wants you to make you think it's about you.
Right.
Oh, you don't have enough faith. You don't have this. You don't have that. Look at all this junk. Doesn't make any difference to God. He can raise a dead person. Multiple dead people.
Right.
He can cause limbs to grow.
Yes.
I mean, instantaneously. Mm-hmm. Nothing is impossible with God.
Yes.
But we got to put our confidence in God, in the gospel, in the grace of God, and not in ourselves.
Right.
This is the message the world needs. This is the message I need. It's the one everybody needs. That it's no longer about you. It's no longer about your hard work. It's no longer about you doing this and doing that and making everything and saying everything just right and looking just right.
Right.
I mean, I've got some extended family here today. I'd be a fool to be lying to you and tell you how spiritual I am. They know me. Amen. I mean, they've been in my house. They know. I'm not saying I'm a reprobate, a horrible person. I'm just saying I'm just a normal person. We're just humans. Jesus was about as normal as you could ever find anybody.
Right.
He was just supernatural.
Right.
He wasn't abnormal. He wasn't weird. He was just supernatural.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Back to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. So, what we read there in Ephesians is again what I was talking about earlier, and that is keep the main thing the main thing.
Right.
Let's make the main thing God, His gospel, His grace, and keep it that way. What happens so often is we get saved, we know the main thing is the Lord, we come to the Lord, and then we make the main thing us.
Right.
And He's telling us over and over throughout the Scripture, keep the main thing the main thing. Keep God the focus. Keep Him the main thing. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
Right.
Right. Paul said, that's it. That's all there is. That there isn't anything else to know. If you know that, you're good. You're going to be all right.
Yeah.
Paul wanted to make the gospel known among the Corinthians. The Corinthians were some of the most paganistic people on the planet. But these are Christians. They'd been born again. But they still had all kinds of issues. I mean, it doesn't take you much of a reading into Corinthians to find out there was incest, there was prostitution, there was drunkenness in church. I'm not talking about down at the club. They were getting drunk in church. And they called it communion. It was the typical attitude. Well, if God likes a little of this, I bet He'll really like a lot. If you're a little good, then God, just be better, which is what religion tells us, then God will like you even more. Well, if He likes a little cup of this wine, man, BYOB next Wednesday, and we'll really get in good with the Lord. So they weren't just overindulging a little, they were getting drunk.
Right.
And there was all sorts of stuff going on. Paul wanted to make the gospel known among these Corinthians, and nothing else. Now, there's plenty of things he could have been dealing with, but he's saying the most important thing is the biggest issue here is the gospel. It's the grace of God. Now, Paul taught a lot of things to the Corinthians. If you read it, you'll see that. But he taught it in relation to the gospel.
Right.
Not relative to their problem, but their problem relative to the gospel of grace. It's not in addition to the gospel, but as an explanation from the gospel. I mean, people would have liked me to preach more about sin. That's not the way it works.
Come on.
You preach the gospel in relation to that.
Mm-hmm.
You don't preach about that and then hope that you can instill some grace. No, you just preach grace and everything else lines up with that. That's why he said you got to make the first thing and keep it the first thing. The main thing needs to be the main thing. The main thing is the grace of God.
Yes.
That's the gospel. The point of the gospel is that God will be glorified. He's glorified through his grace. And Scripture even says throughout eternity, he will be glorified because of his grace. The angels would like to look into this.
Yeah.
They can't experience it.
Right.
I've heard it said that the one song angels can't sing, and we know they're singing all the time, the one song they can't sing is Amazing Grace.
Yes.
They can't experience it. They will never experience it.
Uh-huh.
The gospel isn't the end game.
Right.
In other words, the gospel isn't the end game of the gospel.
Right.
God is. But the gospel is the only way to really understand God.
Right.
You won't understand God by just reading the Old Testament without an understanding of grace. It looks like he's really a mean person.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just waiting for an opportunity to mess up your life.
Yep.
You cannot really understand God or know God without grace, without the gospel of grace. And the purpose of that gospel of grace is so that we can come to God. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. We're about done. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that would be him for us, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit.
Yes.
So salvation is salvation, because God is the reward.
Yes. Yes.
Heaven isn't heavenly because of its location.
Right.
Heaven is heavenly because God's there.
Yes. Exactly.
God makes all things awesome.
Mm-hmm.
God is the reward of the gospel.
Yes.
And every other gift comes from him. James 1:17, you don't have to go there, Sheila, but James 1:17 simply says, every good and perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, no change, nor shadow of turning.
Yes.
He's the same.
Yes.
He's never been mean, vindictive. Jesus is the exact representation of God.
Yes.
There isn't another God shows up in the New Testament with a different attitude. It's the God of the Old Testament in flesh. So when you see Jesus moving and ministering and operating, interacting with people, that's God. It isn't a better God. It isn't a nicer, kinder, gentler God. It's just God. It's the same God. But because without an understanding of grace, you see the God of the Old Testament in a whole different way. That's why it's not accurate to define God from an Old Testament perspective.
Right.
Nothing wrong with the Old Testament. There's plenty of truth there. It's all true. But without seeing it through the eyes of the new covenant,
yep. Yep.
The better covenant,
yes.
Then it's a distortion.
That's right.
It's a religion.
That's right.
Praise God.
Amen.
We don't worship the gospel.
Right.
We worship God. Psalm 73, verse 26. Psalm 73, verse 26. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Mm-hmm. When everything else is gone, money, things, life, the one thing that remains is God. We get God. I'm saying this morning, be engrossed by grace. Be engulfed in grace. Nothing deserves our obsession like the gospel.
Amen.
It's not about religion. People think, well, you're obsessive about this. That's good. That's fine with me. That's what I think. I think we need to be obsessed with the gospel. I think we need to be obsessed with grace. We need to be engulfed in grace. We need to live every moment of our life from that perspective.
Yes, Lord.
That's the most attractive thing that you can offer anybody.
Yep.
Grace, mercy, forgiveness. Mm-hmm. We look at people and we see all their flaws, we see all their issues, we see all their crap. Mm-hmm. And so we end up dealing with them from that external perspective. But God's just the opposite. He's like a mother. Right? A love that is not requiring anything. You love them because they're yours. God sees the heart problem. He sees the issue inside. So he doesn't punish them for the external behavior. He deals with the internal problem, their heart. The church, we have effectively done it just the opposite. We want to fix them all up, get them cleaned up, get them stopped doing that. Don't be going there. Don't look like that. Come on, get your act together. You're an embarrassment. You're all of these things. Never getting to the problem. The problem of the heart. The problem that they are just alienated from God. All they really need is God.
Yes.
They need to know grace. They need to know they're accepted in all of their mess. Not when you get it kind of fixed up or all fixed up, but just as you are. We sing the songs, but we don't really believe it.
Come on.
Or we say, just as you are, come, and then you better get your act together immediately after.
Uh-huh.
No, we're as screwed up after as we are before.
Come on.
We just got different screw-ups. And then we make ourselves even bigger hypocrites because we try to fake it. We try to pretend like we don't have any problems. It's because we're saved, after all. We're Christians. Well, I'm not asking you to admit to anything. Just, you know, do a little self-analysis.
What?
Your issue may not be my issue, but I guarantee you, you've got an issue. I don't know what it is. I don't want to know what it is. I don't care what it is. I only see Christ and Him crucified.
Amen.
And that's what you need to see when you look at you.
Yes.
Not your issues, not your doubt, your unbelief, your aggravations, your issues, all that. But just see Christ and Him crucified. That's good enough. That's all you need. And know that then because of that, you are accepted by God. You have a right to expect favor. You have a right to expect financial blessing. You have a right to expect healing and deliverance. You have a right to have your relationships restored. Not because of you. Because of Him. You can believe and you can put your confidence in Him and not in you. And I'm telling you, all the things that I've been telling you, and I could tell you many, many more, that's what I learned. I didn't learn it through all the Bible studies that I taught. I didn't learn it through the new converts classes that I taught. I didn't even learn it from the junior high Sunday school. I didn't learn it from the bus ministries. I didn't learn it from pastoring. And I didn't learn it from evangelizing. I learned it by being in that position and knowing my inadequacies. And having to depend on God. That glorifies God. And it causes us to do what Jesus wanted us to do in the very beginning, which is come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. It's not about you anymore. You can relax and watch God do what only God can do.
Amen.
So grace is something, we need to keep it, we need to guard it, we need to enjoy it so that we can behold our God.
Amen.
That's the greatest, everybody's always say, focus on Jesus. Well, you know, I guess you get it in your mind, a picture of this blonde-headed guy, you know, with a neatly trimmed beard and some robes and sandals. I'm sure that's a distortion. You know, but that's what we're thinking we got to do when we're supposed to be focused on the Lord. No, the way you focus, grace is a person.
Yes.
It is Jesus. The gospel is a person.
Yes.
Focus, that's what he's talking about when he's saying, keep your eye on him. Single-minded. What? Grace. It's the only thing that'll work. It's the only thing that can get you through this. The only thing that will help others. Keep the main thing. The main thing. Amen?
Amen.
Galatians 6:14. But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. 1 Peter 2:2-3. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. How do you grow? By a 10-step sermon on how to heal or how to do this or how to do that? No. By recognizing and understanding and accepting the grace of God. By knowing it. By focusing on it. By making it the priority. I said Wednesday night that all things, eventually, all things merge into one. This is it's from a movie. A river runs through it. I get all sorts of spiritual insight from carnal movies. Actually, God speaks to us all the time, so it doesn't make any difference. You can get it anywhere. But at the end of that film, the brother, the sole surviving family member, after his parents died, his brother died, is fly fishing, and he says, you know, he's talking about kind of, you know, the whole sum of life, because he's an old man now. And he said he realizes that eventually all things merge into one. Fathers, sons, mothers, daughters, brothers, sisters, I mean, everything merges into one. And that's the way the movie ends. He says, they come to the conclusion that all things become one and a river runs through it. Now, if that isn't a description of God, he's restoring all things. He's bringing all things back to him. And there is a river that flows from the throne of God. Focus on him. Keep the main thing, and the river will flow through it.
Yes.
The Spirit of God will do what it is intended to do. When we recognize that oneness, that our acceptance is grace, there's a river that flows. There is this powerful Spirit, because Jesus said himself, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water.
Amen.
If you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much space. Amen? If you're not trusting God, you're redundant. There's too many others. Someone said it like this. If you aren't supernatural, you're superficial. And it's not hard to be supernatural. You already are. The moment you accepted Christ, the moment you got born again, you became supernatural. You became an eternal being. So why settle for superficiality when you can have the supernatural?
Right.
Just by believing.
Amen.
In his grace, in his goodness.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Keep the main thing the main thing.
Amen.
And watch what happens.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
I said it Wednesday, I'll say it again. R.W. Schock always said, and I agreed with this, you don't have any problems. All you need is faith in God. Hallelujah. Amen. That's coming from the grace perspective.
Amen.
Problems shrink. They diminish when confronted with a big God,
yes,
as it was said here. The mountains become low. The valleys come up. Everything is smooth sailing.
Hallelujah.
When you trust the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Trust in His grace. Trust in His goodness. Trust in His love. Experience the fullness of God the way Jesus did. Amen?
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. Have a great rest of your Mother's Day. Thanks again, moms, for being you and all that you do. We appreciate it. Everybody stay safe. Be praying for this weather to go around us.
Yes.
And someone else will get it. Hallelujah. That's what we do as Christians. Praise the Lord. Back to Oklahoma where it came. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.